I actually think that the Jacob Zuma rape trial was a far more significant event than what we have allowed it to be in our conversations and in writings. We should have documented every aspect of that trial so that we can remind ourselves of a society how not to respond to rape allegations, how not to to vocalize support for the accused. Because Khwezi was lynched publicly by Jacob Zuma supporters. Now, let me be clear, Zuma was acquitted. Legally, he's not a rapist. It's important to say that. But the way Khwezi was treated, the way Fezekile was treated in that court, on the streets, the threats that were made against her and her mother, I felt that it was an opportune time to document that history and to also make commentary about sexual violence and the language of power. That yes, there was an acquittal, but Mr. Zuma did break some rules of morality, rules of friendship, rules of what uncles and fathers should, how they should treat the little girls who are their friends' children. I must just say, I don't see myself as someone who knew her very well from a context of having been in her life for a long time. There are people who knew her better, and I relied on them to fill me in on the kind of person that she was. But we interacted, we spoke about the rape trial, how it affected her. We spoke about her dreams, her fears, her plans for the future. And I used several people to get to Fezekile. I used some of her childhood friends from exile. Casey Khwale is one of the people who led me to her. Ronnie Castrels led me to her. Kimim Sidi. So she had a life full of loved ones, people who loved and adored her, and I got to her via them because I thought it was important to establish a relationship of trust. I can't just be a journalist, just, hey, I'm Redi, I want to write about you. That wasn't going to work. So I thought, let me get people who can vouch an account for me in order to gain her trust, because I think she was quite vulnerable.
The way I feel as a woman and the way I feel as a South African has always been echoed by Redi Tlhabi. I listened to her during the trial on the radio, and I think it's hit a nerve with women and with South Africans generally. I think we're tired of being abused in more than one way.
I am not challenging a court judgment in the book. I am merely reflecting on how sexual violence, power relations between men and women are so skewed in our society, and that we should have a never again moment. And that's the purpose of the book. There were people who were quietly supporting her, people who stood by her, people who provided for her financially, people who were there when she was feeling emotionally weak. And I hope that I have paid enough tribute to them. They're not all mentioned, because you can't write about every single incident in the book. And where I have failed to mention people, I hope they forgive me, but I hope that there'll be more books to celebrate their solid presence in her life. Having said that, as a collective, as a country, I think Fezekile was failed. Why could she not live safely in South Africa after the trial? Why was she so demonized? Why were the placards of burn the allowed to be seen in broad daylight during the trial? But most importantly for me, why was a man who in broad daylight in a court of law told the world that he had consensual sex with his friend's child, why was that man allowed to be our president?
Before coming to the actual issue of that happened with Khwezi, I had to also understand the power that one has in terms of a position. It doesn't matter whether it's at work or it's at home, but the gender power, the state power that you will have depending on the position that you would be. So I took a lot.
I think the abuse of power and the abuse of justice and the law, which is reflected in Redi's book, I think it silenced a lot of people. And I think it took the voice away, and we only heard one person's voice. We didn't hear the other. We didn't hear the voice of the abused, the voice of the person who'd been attacked. And that reflected for all South Africans.
You know what? I do think that we accept court judgments, but we can certainly reflect on them, comment on them, analyze them, And in my view, when I put a gender lens on the trial itself, it was unprecedented to have somebody's sexual history, entire sexual history, aired in court. You may rightly argue that it was relevant, there was an application for that to happen. It was relevant, it wasn't all relevant. Only the cases where she was accused of falsely accusing men, only those cases should have been heard in court. But what happened in that trial is that her entire sexual history was aired in public. And it felt as if she was on trial rather than Jacob Zuma. Nobody questioned Zuma's sexual history and conduct. If you ask me how her family's doing, I would put the spotlight on her mom and say, she has people who've been there who'll never abandon her, but we're not Fezeka. She only had one child, one daughter, and that's the child she buried. And that's why I wrote this book, because I think that it demonstrated how disempowering a legal process can be to the very people who need its protection the most. The public humiliation, the stigma, the accusations, families sometimes wanting stuff to go away, and that happens in our communities. How could you lay a charge against your uncle? We must deal with it as a family. I want to say to those little girls and those young women, there is support out there. Find the community networks of women who've been through this, who can support you through it. Don't sit on your own, because when you're on your own, it is overwhelming. And I want to say to those women that if you choose silence, choose it because you choose it. But don't choose it because you've been threatened or you feel that there's no space for you. In the book, there are also rape survivors, other rape survivors that I speak about, the women who survived sexual violence in Togoza during those political uprisings. Women were raped. Nobody has gone back to ask how they're doing. So the proceeds from the sale of the book, I obviously want to compensate those women so that they can have something. But because the bulk of the story is about Fezeka, I have stated to those who are close to her mom that it's only right that she gets the proceeds of the book, and that's what's going to happen.